Okay. Are we going, Dimitri?
You're going.
Okay, perfect. Welcome to the June board meeting of Creating the Future. We are so pleased to be together again today and to have all of you here. My name is Gail Valariat. I'm the chair of the board at this point in time and a consultant to community benefit organizations. I live in Guelph, Ontario, Canada. And we're going to do a quick go-around and then talk about some of the logistics of our meeting, but a quick go-around so that you know who else is at the table. Anybody prepared to get us going? Introduce yourselves.
Sure. I'm Owen from Southern New Jersey.
Beautiful. Next.
I'm in Metropolis with Creating the Future, and I'm in Tucson, Arizona.
I'm Candace Grimm. I'm new to this. Today's my first day. I'm operations coordinator with Creating the Future, and I, too, am in Tucson.
Woohoo!
Yeah!
There's Alex.
This is Justin Pollack, board member, and I'm in Washington, D.C.
I'm Alexandra Peters. I'm a board member, and I am in Connecticut at the moment, but I'm typically from New York.
Thank you.
Mark Riffey, I'm a board member. I am in Northwest Arkansas.
And last but not least,
we have two, I think.
Yeah, there's two.
Two, yes.
Rebecca.
I'll fall into line, assuming that I just came right in the exact time of introductions. I'm Alex, and I'm in Stockholm, Sweden, but originally from San Francisco.
Rebecca Hurd, I'm the board documentarian. I'm in McCall, Idaho.
And we're trying to talk Rebecca into turning her camera out her window so that we can see the view that she is enjoying. You know, one of these.
I just looked at the screens and they're too blurry.
Okay. So maybe at one of our future meetings we can all walk around our space and show each other where we exactly are, because I'm very curious. However, for now, we are, Creating the Future is an organization that envisions communities where people are living well, individually and collectively, and we know that such a future is possible simply because it's not impossible. And so accomplishing that is our 10-year mission to change the questions that are embedded in the day-to-day work of individuals and organizations so that everyone naturally brings out the best in one another and in the rest of the world. That's the context in which everything that we're going to talk about today happens, and we are thrilled to be here all together virtually, but also with anyone who is watching via the Walking the Talk blog. And so that you know, we are so thrilled for you to be participating with us today and are eagerly anticipating that you will participate through Twitter. And in order to do that, please use the hashtag CTFuture. Your questions, your input, your ideas are really appreciated, and we stop every so often to check in on where the Twitter feed is and who is there with us. And we want you to be part of our meeting as well, so you're welcome. Goodness.
Something going on in my kitchen. I don't know what.
Okay. We have a great meeting today that's going to start, I guess we'll start with regrets, just to say that there's one of our members, two of our members, I should say, who are absent today. One is Carl Wilding, who is from London, and the other is Hilde Gottlieb, who is usually sitting next to Dimitri and soon to be Candace. And she is also away today. Otherwise, the rest of us are here and present and accounted for. So, it is our custom to begin our meetings by talking about what has been inspiring us in the last little while, over the past 30 days, and things that we've been noticing in our work or in our lives that are causing us to recognize that life is awesome. So we're going to open that up to anybody who is ready to get us going, and we'll go around the table.
I'll start.
Dimitri.
I'll start. My awesome is sitting next to me, which is Candace, who has joined us. And I just can't imagine where we're going to be able to fly to next. She is, as I know you know, Gail, because you got to see the interview with her and look at what she, I believe, is capable of. And it's just amazingly awesome. So I'm very excited about that, and that's what I wanted to share.
Nice.
Thanks. You're going to make me blush. Let me write as this shirt. Well, I'm just excited to be here. I'm really excited for this opportunity, and like Dimitri said, see where we can go, see where we can take this thing.
Well, Candace, we welcome you. It's exciting for any organization to have its first paid employee, but in particular, there is just so much that we are excited about you being part of and involved in. And as I said before the broadcast started, please remember that this is a group of people who have lots of knowledge and experience, and please count on us to not only answer your questions, but to work with you directly and indirectly in ways that can help you learn and grow, and there's no question that's too small.
Okay.
So, yeah, we're looking forward to lots of conversation back and forth and ideas flowing and being shared.
Perfect.
Mm-hmm. I think that qualifies for the Creating the Future organizational awesome.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Thank you.
I'll jump in. So, Justin Pollock again. And I have two. Some of you have seen the first part of this, which is I have been invited to create a curriculum for a local community college that I proposed basically building entirely around the Creating the Future framework. It's for emerging and sort of the language around it, but basically leaders who are not in positional leadership in organizations, and so I'm taking a tack of really mapping the leadership work that I'm doing with the framework, because I think they are interchangeable. And so there's a lot of excitement. I still don't have 100% of a commitment on their end yet, although I think it's pretty likely it's going to work out one way or the other. So I see a tremendous amount of potential here of bringing things together. And then that's pretty personal, but on a very personal side, last night I was putting my daughter to bed. She's 7.5, and she's gotten into that why phase. And we were drilling down, why do you need to go to sleep? Well, because you have to go to school. Why do I have to go to school? Because I have to learn. Why do you have to learn? So that you can be smart. Why do I need to be smart? And I said, well, so that you can make the world a better place. And she looked at me, and she said, well, why? And I said, because that's the best thing that you could ever do. And she looked at me, and she goes, well, do you do that? And I think for the first time in my life, I could look at her and say, every day I try to do that, and that's what my work does. So that's my thank you out there to the world that has put me in this place to be able to do that and be truly authentic when my daughter asked me that question.
That's amazing.
Yeah, that's pretty cool.
Okay, top that, you guys.
Justin, is your camera off or?
It's on. Are you not seeing the video?
No.
No, I see it.
I see it.
Yeah.
I guess you don't want to see me, Dimitri.
Dimitri, is your monitor off?
Yeah, I'm playing World of Warcraft over here.
Well, Justin, with those questions, your daughter's welcome to join us for any board meetings that she would like. I think it would be good, really helping to delve into the heart of the matter.
Yes.
Alex, you should tell us about your weekend.
Yeah. So I went to the lovely island. Work with me, because my Swedish pronunciation is probably about as bad as all of yours, despite the fact I've lived here for a year. But it's an island called Nye, which is about 3 hours outside of Stockholm. And it's absolutely beautiful. It's like the quintessential Sweden idyllic setting. It's got red cabins and green grass and wildflowers, and I kept imagining that I would have like Rick Steves flamenco music following behind me wherever I went. So that was like, beautiful. So I went out there for a night and bicycled around. So that was certainly a personal awesome. But then the other awesome I want to share is the absolute best book that I've read in a couple of years. Gail, I shared this with you. It's a book called The Purpose Economy, which I think many of you guys would be interested in as well. It's by a guy named Aaron Hurst, who's an Ashoka Fellow and a social entrepreneur. I founded Taproot Foundation. And I helped to set up a speaking gig of his here in Stockholm, because I'm friends with his co-founder. And I set it up just as kind of any other speaking gig. But unbelievable. When we talk about creating the future, I feel like he's one of those guys that sees the future. And what's so impressive is that when he's talking, nothing he says sounds all that revolutionary until you realize how he's just kind of putting all these pieces together. But the crux being that we're going through different ages, and so we've gone through the agrarian age, the industrial age, the information economy, and now we're moving into the next age, which is the purpose economy, which is about people finding purpose and meaning in their work and in their life. And so I can't do the book justice other than to say that it's rare that a book gets me that excited, and I think it's really nicely aligned for you guys as well. So I'll put the Amazon link in here in the chat so you guys can check it out. But yeah, highly recommend it.
Wow. And the week, the conference, the whole national conference that you went to, can you share a little bit about that? I've been thinking about that all month.
Oh, that's so nice of you. It's actually coming up. It's the first week of July, so it hasn't been yet.
So it hasn't just happened yet. Okay.
Yeah, so just getting things in place now. But yeah, full report for sure to come.
Okay. Alexandra, what's been amazing for you?
Well, I have been working on the past year on a novel, which sort of happened by accident because in Connecticut, I live in a house that was built in 1794, so I went to do the star research on it and got so fascinated by it that I started just playing around. And honestly, I don't even remember when I started working on this because I must have done it in my sleep because I found a fully written chapter in June of last year that I was like, whoa. But I definitely wrote it. And so I've been spending the rest this whole year working on that and researching life in 1833, which is when the book takes place. And I finished the final draft last week, which is the first draft, of course. I mean, not final. I've finished the whole book. It's the first draft. I haven't read it all week, so I'm going to go back and see what it looks like. And I'm sort of nervous, kind of like giving birth. It's like I have to send my baby out into the world and see what happens.
So Alexander, does it take place in your house?
It does, yes.
Oh my gosh.
And I have learned all about hearth cooking, and which is mostly cooking right on the floor with coals. I've learned all about, I'm pretty good at life in 1833. I don't know. I think I could do it. Sort of no electricity, no running water, which actually they do in Sweden all the time, probably on this very island you went to visit. Their house, that's their idea of getting away from things. So I have done that. But if we do it as a vacation, we go camping, right? That's fun to have, like, you know, for a few days to have that stuff. This is year-round. This is how they lived, and they didn't know anything else. And it was an interesting time period because it was at the very beginning of the Industrial Revolution. Things are starting to be manufactured. There are mills that are changing things. So I was interested in it because of that, and because it replicates a lot of our time. But I just always also been extremely interested. I collect girlhood samplers from that time period, and it didn't even dawn on me till I was writing the book. Like, oh my God, my house is full of this stuff. So. Yeah. That's my big news.
Now, this is in Connecticut?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And Northwest Connecticut is kind of the wilder part of the state. I mean, it's very the last to be populated and last to be settled, and still not that heavily settled.
It's because
the weather up here on this is terrible in the winter. And so I figured out that it must have been a tavern because no farmer would build a house here. It doesn't make sense. But it is halfway between the two nearest towns. So
That makes complete sense.
So you can research 1830s ales. And
I did have to, yes.
Darn.
Try out some recipes.
Wow. So do you want to use this moment, Alexandra, to say the corollary to your book?
Well, yeah, and I was one of the first two board members, Mark Riffey, and I think were along with Dimitri and Hildy, and this has been an incredibly exciting and amazing group to be part of. But what I've realized is my focus has been elsewhere, particularly in the past 7 or 8 months when I really was just working on the book all the time, and so I told Dimitri and Gail and Hildy that this will be my last board meeting because I really need to focus on this and get started on the next book immediately. And I don't feel I'm doing justice to the amazing work that is being done here, although I plan to always be involved and remain very focused because I think what Creating the Future is doing is, in fact, creating the future. And it has been just a wonderful experience to be part of this group and to know everybody. And I feel I have lifetime friendships from this. So I'm very sad to be stepping down, but I feel like I do believe very strongly that if you're on a board, you have to really honor that commitment. And I don't feel I can while I'm working on the book. So that is my other news.
Mm-hmm. Thank you for sharing that.
just a comment, having been one of the four original board members, or being one of the four original board members, and I know I had said this to you, and I want to say it publicly, that your influence on where Creating the Future went and where it's going is there and is permanent. And you personally helped me see some things from a perspective that I was not seeing. And I want to thank you for that. I will tell you that you're a fellow, so you can never leave. So you will be you'll be part of the family here, sort of in perpetuity. But it has been a very interesting evolution in thought. And you brought a for someone who can be stereotyped by position and activity, you brought a very unique perspective and in many ways sort of game-changing perspective on a lot of things that we've been doing. I don't want to take a lot of time with this, but if folks are interested, I'm happy to talk about that, you know, directly. But I just wanted to honor you, Alexandra, and thank you so much for what you have contributed in so many ways to making this what it is today. So thank you.
Well, thank you. Yep. Okay. Yep, absolutely. I echo that, Dimitri. Alexandra, you're going to be so missed, especially because you always ask us to get to the point, and it's a wonderful, wonderful gift that you have given and a legacy that you're leaving behind, and this organization wouldn't be what it is now without you, so you will be very, very missed. But we're so, so glad about the evolution of your book and that you've been creating the future for the past year. And probably much, much longer than that without even realizing it. I love that story of how you've been collecting all the materials that are going to be part of this book for so long without realizing that that's what they were about. Yeah. Brilliant. Brilliant, brilliant. Okay. Leave taking is never a pleasant thing to think about, but we know we're releasing you into good work. So who else is going to talk about awesome?
Oh, I will. Last month, my wife and my oldest son and his daughters and the in-laws and my mom all went out to Portland for my youngest son's graduation, or almost graduation. We spent a week in Portland and It was American Craft Beer Week, and it was Graduate Week, and it was his birthday week, so we just had a great time.
Did you make it to Voodoo Donut?
You know, some part of the crowd did. I did not, but of course the pink box did make it back to the house, so it was all good.
Okay, context, you guys. What does that mean?
Voodoo Donut is this bizarre phenomenon in Denver and Portland, and they make really crazy donuts. You know, donuts with bacon on them, donuts with cereal all over them, you name it. They're just the wildest donuts you've ever seen. So you see people walking around Portland with a box that's pink, bright pink, and that's what their donut boxes are colored. And you see them everywhere, especially downtown at Saturday Market. So it's just one of those touristy things you got to do when you go there. But you should expect to stand in line unless you're there very early in the morning on a weekday.
Ooh. And of course, they have an actual voodoo donut as well. It's like four or five donuts stuck together as if it has a head and legs, and it's a jelly donut. And you can take a pretzel stick that comes with it to poke it as if it were actually a voodoo doll. Probably, depending what you've been doing that night in Portland, could make more sense than that.
Yeah, they have some, I will call them, curiously shaped donuts. for all ages of people who like to entertain themselves with donuts and pastry shapes.
Good Lord.
such a tactful way of expressing that.
Well, we're glad that you had a good time and that your son almost graduated.
Yeah, he's a couple hours short, so he'll be finishing up shortly, but they like for them to walk with their class if they're on the home stretch. So it was a very good time, and it's probably the biggest smile I've ever seen on his face, so he was clearly pretty proud of himself.
That's good. What did he study?
He's a poli sci major, and he's pondering law school.
Pretty cool. Thanks, Mark. Rebecca or Sydney?
All right, I'll jump in while it's quiet. I'm battling a background of chatter, so I keep muting and off-muting because I don't want to disturb the group. But, you know, what's awesome right now is I spent the last couple of months and will for the rest of this year focusing on doing things that are outside of my comfort zone. So I've taken on designing a graduate level course on social impact measurement, and that's been absorbing quite a bit of my time outside of work lately. And the course actually starts in September, so it will start on September 8th. So it's awesome in more than ways than one. It's awesome. It's also can be frightening at times. So
you designed it and you're teaching it.
Exactly. From absolutely. And it's a field experience, so it's mixed with an actual opportunity to carry out grant review for, I'm sorry, evaluation, not review, evaluation for both individual major donors and private foundations and corporate foundations in the area that I've recruited to participate as well. But it's not just a, you know, how-to course. It's really more that the idea is that when the course is over, they'll understand both the challenge, the issues and the opportunity of social impact measurement, and we'll be able to take a look at it from the vantage point of critiquing it as well as understanding what some of the methodologies are that are being used today.
Hmm. Wow. And who will be taking the course?
It's a graduate course on nonprofit leadership. The Masters of Nonprofit Leadership at the University of Penn School of Social Policy and Practice.
University of what? I'm sorry?
University of Pennsylvania.
Penn, okay.
but it's their School of Social Policy and Practice.
I will look forward to, Sydney, to hearing, once the course starts, what you hear from students in terms of what they see the highest potential of social impact measurement to be. I have a strong sense that we could learn a lot from the perspective that people are bringing to that conversation.
Absolutely, absolutely. Mm-hmm. I'm looking forward to learning through the process as well. I mean, I think it's one thing to just present the tools and methodologies that are being used, but what I'm most excited about is the opportunity to really engage the students in the opportunity to critique that and to look at what are the highest level, what are the challenges as well as the opportunities. And really, from my perspective, to emphasize impact measurement as a learning, as the beginning of learning as opposed to the end of reviewing a grant.
Wow. Wow, that's really powerful.
Yes, it is.
I'm thinking about Justin and what you're working on, and the, it's sort of like a through line of leaders and then leadership and then measurement. So very, very, very interesting.
Mm. Well, I think it's really interesting, and Sydney, I thank you for sharing that, because I was just the other day stumbling. I was at a conference where they were talking about outcomes so much, and I was like, well, outcomes actually has no value to it. And I was thinking, let's talk about the benefits.
Like, that's right.
Because, you can have a bad outcome and be really good at it. And, so it's, it's like thinking about what is that outcome supposed to be doing, and also this sense of the outcome is actually external to what you're doing. Yet we sometimes, really the output is what we have control over as an organization. But anyway, that's a whole other conversation.
Yeah, it's true. But I mean, I think when you look at how the field of philanthropy and impact measurement has changed over the last 20 years, I can at least say I am excited now about what I feel is either reaching or we have reached a tipping point where it's about learning.
Yeah.
I think as recent as probably, 5 years ago, it was just a small group small segment really talking about the learning aspect of it. But I'm starting to see it now. And I think part of it is this parallel universe of this conversation about failure and the need to approach failure, again, not as an endpoint, but as a node for learning. And the first portion of this course is really looking at setting the landscape now of what it looks like. My hope is that the majority of it will be giving them an opportunity to wrestle with both the challenges and the opportunity of it. Yeah.
That's so great.
Yeah, sounds like a great way to be spending your time. Rebecca.
I've been working with one community benefit organization in particular, and our relationship's evolving, and we're, in the mechanics of it, have a contract that we're working on where it says, I am coming to you as the change catalyst. And then all of the work we do together is internally in the organization, the spending of time with individuals and collectively as a staff, and then as well as with the board. But then this organization kind of put out their calling card to the universe of, we're all about collective impact and using all the buzzwords, but they had no substance years ago. They just made that kind of their positioning pitch, but they were not walking the talk. So they started a program in a very low-income rural community. This is back down outside of Boise, and they did very good programmatic siloed work around your typical pre-K, out-of-school, career aspirations culture within one school district. But again, it was all within the school in silos. So now we're evolving with this organization positioned as kind of the change catalyst to say, let's start looking at community and community assets and all the resources in the community. And the superintendent, for the first time ever, he no longer uses "I am pragmatic" before he says everything, because he has now stepped into this place that he, because he inherited this very siloed program from another superintendent. And now we're allowing that to change, with, and but also manage the message to the world is, it's not that the funding ran out. The thing was kind of flawed out of the gate, without saying it like that. You're not going to find $500,000 every year to fund this thing. So some funders fund shiny objects for 2 years and then wipe their hands. But so helping the community see this was not a failure, but we are now actually inviting community into what can be. So on Friday, we have a meeting, because I said to them, let's walk the talk and get the heck out of the school district office. We will no longer meet in the school district. So we meet all in the community, and Friday we are at their hospital with the CEO there. We're having the police department there, health and welfare, and I guess, I don't know what's going to happen, but it's going to be wonderful, and I'm trusting the process, and I'm bringing my, you know, sheets of paper to capture the awesome, but the CEO of this United Way, that's the organization, she's wanting on her watch to shift the organization to actually be relevant. So this is part of the relevancy, is leading out this, this change with this community to no longer be within the school walls, but yeah, the minute you start the conversation, so-and-so shares a gem of something that's been going on in this library that no one knew about. So I think it's going to be exciting, and, you know, the, I guess the fear is more the excitement about what can be, and I don't really know how it's going to go, but it will be great. And that's on Friday coming up. So.
Wow.
And I just want to do a thank you to Justin for all that he shares in the listserv with what he's doing with his program, and Sydney, and everyone's kind of really evolved in their thing, but it at least poked me in the butt to reach out to the ones I've been talking about in my head. Like, why am I not connecting with the, you know, Boise State University? Why am I not reaching out to so-and-so? And I met a woman in the bleachers at a graduation whose husband, she and her husband fund everything they called nonprofit programs at a community college, because they walk the talk of, you know, education and learning communities. So I'm like, let's have coffee. But it was just kind of, you know, getting a little dose of Justin sprinkled, said, why not just go have that conversation? What can happen?
Yeah. Holy mackerel. Imagine we all get to have a little dose of Justin sprinkled on top. I love it.
Voodoo Donut should make one of those.
Did you say there's a Voodoo Donut for one of those? I didn't.
Yeah.
Yeah. They should make a Justin Donut.
Oh my gosh.
There was a tweet a few minutes ago.
Oh great.
It is missing Alexandra already, and this is from Hildy, listening in the background as she was packing to hit the road. So.
Love it.
Just wanted to shout out to her.
Okay.
I think they already have the donut. It's the Voodoo Donut, just poking holes at things.
Well, Carl and Hildy, you are definitely missed. We trust that you will be watching this later on after the meeting is done, so you are being missed as we speak. My awesome is, it was going to be something, but listening to you, Rebecca, you reminded me of one thing that really blew my mind, and there's been a whole bunch of them in the last little while, but I was having lunch with one of our fellows the other day, which I don't get to do very often, of course, live in person, but Karen Smith happened to be driving through with her parents through Guelph, and so they stopped and we had lunch together, and her parents were delightfully wonderful people. And you know, I tried not to talk too much shop with her because her mom and dad were there, but I asked her how things were going, because I'd done some planning work with she and her board last year, and so I, you know, I wanted to just have the short little get me caught up on what's going on. And the organization is called the Community Child Abuse Council, and they are in the process of rebranding. They're going to create a new name for their organization. They're doing a whole bunch of interesting things, but one of them is considering their new name, and they went from a vision of a community where that's free of child abuse to a vision where they named that thriving children create thriving communities. That's what they are aiming themselves towards. So they're thinking, and I don't think I'm telling tales out of school, but they are thinking that the name of their organization will include the concept of thriving children. And so imagine such a thing as like the Hamilton Organization for Thriving Children. And she indicated that whereas they had been really focused on the therapeutic work that they do without really seeing the broader context of prevention and education around child abuse, that as a result of the planning work, now things are started, the paradigm is shifting and cracking open more and more to the point where they're seeing themselves working in partnership with organizations that they would probably never have built relationships with easily because they were finding, you know, they were just so darn busy treating the crises that children were experiencing, and so it was so invigorating to find out that it was the planning process itself that helped them take that step back to recognize that there are bigger and broader conversations that they would like to be having with their community. And you know, they've done really amazing things through Karen's leadership to get dialogue going, but here they are as an organization now starting to change themselves and how they're approaching their work. So it was absolutely it just lit me up to recognize that you know, you used the word catalyst, Rebecca, and that this process that we all use, and sometimes we take for granted that it's amazing, when you see it happening, what's happening to an organization as a result, it really is quite awesome. And my second awesome is, Hildy, for your sake, is that your hairdo is just stunning. So, Dimitri, who else is there? Have you seen any others in the Twitter stream besides Hildy?
Just Alex and Justin letting people know that the meeting is underway.
Okay.
And Alex said it's a monthly highlight for him. So join in the discussion right now. So yay, yeah. Alex, you're a monthly highlight for us. So
I was clearly just making a play for the Dimitri retweet, and I got that. So my plan worked.
Oh boy. Well, so let's keep in mind a couple of things. Today, you know, when I've been spending a lot of time watching our meetings, which tells you a lot about me, that watching meetings is actually turning into being quite an interesting and wonderful thing. But you know, it's what I've realized is that this technology of having the ability to watch what happens during our meetings, and as a board chair, to be able to take to just sit back and see what's happening as a teacher, as a trainer, as an educator, and as a facilitator, to see the flow of meetings, to recognize, oh, this is happening at this point, and, well, that takes too long to do, and that sort of thing, is a real gift. And I don't know any other board chairs who get a chance to watch meetings happen and then pull them apart and ask themselves, what could we do differently or better in order to make the experience so great? And certainly there's no board chairs out there who have individuals watching the meeting from afar who they're also needing to think their way through, how do we make this the best experience for them as well? So I'm going to ask you today to think about the things, and because we have you with us, Candace, you know, we're all going to be conscious of making sure that we're trying not to be, you know, talk too much on the insider track, that we all know each other and we kind of know what we're talking about except for donuts and pink boxes. So let's pay attention to some context or background if we're talking about things that others may not know too much about. And I guess for the sake of folks who aren't tweeting but are watching anyway, if you want to learn more about Creating the Future and what this organization is all about, let us know, and we would be happy to share that information with you offline. So if you're intrigued by what we're doing but you don't want to participate live via Twitter, that's cool, but do let us know, and we would be happy to link with you. And if the rest of you see things that are going on or that you have thoughts about the meetings themselves and how we're doing this work together, and you want to share those, I'm very excited about talking about how to facilitate the best meetings possible for everybody's purposes. So I'm hoping that's a preview of coming attractions for us. So off we go. We have an agenda then today that we want to work our way through. And the first item in that, the next item in it is our consent agenda, our consent agenda item, which is the minutes of the May 2014 meeting, which was attached to the email that you received in your board package, as well as to the Walking the Talk blog. No, that's not true. We haven't posted the minutes from the May meeting on the blog because they're not approved. So I'm looking for a motion to approve and hoping for, I want to say two things. First, to thank Rebecca for such an amazing job. I mean, those were thorough minutes, like holy mackerel. And so I'm glad to know that there's two of us watching these meetings. So thank you for your hard work. And also, I'd like to get a conversation going, if not today, at a future meeting, about what board members would like to see in our minutes. I'm not prepared to make that decision on your behalf, but I would like us to talk a little bit about what you want our minutes to include. But for now, can there be a motion to approve these minutes?
So moved.
Okay, who, that was Justin?
Yes.
And seconded?
Alexandra.
Alexandra, thank you. Any objections to these minutes? Any comments?
Just echoing yours that Rebecca did a great job.
Yeah, they were very thorough.
Very thorough. Absolutely. Okay. And today's, and you have seen Hildy's board report. It came to you in the form of a video. We won't go into any great detail about it because it's in our consent agenda, but I did want to acknowledge that it's there, and thanks, Hildy, for that. Today's topic is connected to the ongoing conversation about financial and I sort of inserted the word resource because we have certainly broadened our conversation over the last couple of months. So resource and financial oversight and the board's role. As we finished, we're going to, for the benefit of people who are watching who may not have familiarity with the approach that we take at Creating the Future, we will be, as always, we start with highest potential and best possible outcomes, and then reverse engineer the conditions for creating success towards those outcomes. And then consider what we would do then on the basis of our understanding of those things. That is our thought framework, and we anticipate and intend that you will see us thinking our way through our questions today on that basis. So we're picking up from where we left off in our last meeting, where we considered in several different ways. And you can see it in the context of the minutes that we took several different stabs at getting a series of questions that would allow us to think our way through the oversight role. And I want to acknowledge that as I was watching the meeting replay, I noticed that we are continuing to have these conversations in the absence of the very concrete and specific plan that the board needs to have in place in order to make this stuff very real. And so I'm of a mind to ask you to consider two things, and that is the questions that we have in front of us today related to the process that we would use and the questions we would ask related to financial oversight, as well as a very practical conversation related to creating a community impact or a plan for community impact that this board comes together to create. So I'm kind of opening up the possibility of a second topic today.
Well, I'm wondering if we should look at the community impact plan question at the next board meeting for two reasons. One is knowing that Hilde in her report talks specifically about trying to make that possible, a gathering, and being able to have her voice present in that conversation. And I think really acknowledging, just as you said in terms of Gail, the process of we need to come at that at saying, what is it that we want that plan to make possible for us so that we can think clearly about how we approach that and how we want to use it. And I think that's a big conversation.
Mm-hmm.
And I wouldn't want to try and put it into today.
Okay. Okay. So without Hilde and without the time available to really dig into the plan itself. Okay. Other thoughts?
I agree, Gail, that the lack of a plan has made it more difficult to really focus on where we want to be, ultimately.
Mm-hmm.
And in the context of the financial umbrella here, mm-hmm, that we're talking about.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So I know we had talked about, at one point in the past, doing this in a face-to-face environment.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering about how to do that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Well, in some of the conversations that I've had over the last couple of weeks with members of the board, what I've heard is, yes, this is a really important thing, and we need to get on with some of the logistical planning so that we can have this thing done, because no one's under the illusion that it's going to be short. So it's going to take us some time, but if we could get it done by the end of the year, that would position us to have, especially once we are in a place where there's funding in place for the work for the program that Creating the Future is doing. Without that, it's going to make it difficult for the board to offer oversight to anything. Mm-hmm. Okay, so Justin, you're proposing then that we stage our July meeting to be about the not only the value of the plan. I'm suggesting is that we partner that with the logistics of how we would make that work happen.
Yeah, and I was just, as we were listening, I mean, that's definitely, I think that there's so much even to what Dimitri was saying about, talking about how to the logistics of making it being in person. But as I was reflecting across our conversations, the other piece that I'm feeling is we are in a unique situation where we're having two parallel conversations. One is the conversation about creating the future and being the board of creating the future and being carrying out our role in that as that entity and that leadership. But a lot of our other conversation, too, is about mapping out new realities for what, in general sense, a board is or financial oversight is. And so we have these two conversations going on that are equally valuable. And I think, part of it may just be us putting that out there and saying, naming it. And that's why I was thinking, July is very intentional about, hey, we need to think about the organization and what it's about and what it's doing, because the process of us talking about how to be just as a leadership body, which is what I feel most of the conversations have been up to date, is absolutely relevant to creating the future, but is also relevant to the rest of the world. Mm-hmm. And that conversation can actually happen without us ever paying any attention to creating the future, and I think that's some of the tension.
Anybody else want to weigh in on that? I think you've made a very good point. So there are two levels at which we have conversations, to paraphrase you, Justin. And in the discussions that I've been having with board members, what I'm realizing and sensing is that there's a willingness to have those, continue to have those conversations at the broader level, but there's a real desire and even a little sense of concern that we're not talking about creating the future itself much. And that is leaving us in a position where sometimes some of the conversation feels so theoretical that we wonder, did we actually do anything for the organization because of this?
Yeah, I think it's that duality of mm-hmm. we are a demonstration and we are an organization at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
It's how do we maximize both of those and not, I'm trying to find a better word than should, one to the for the other, but you know, minimize one role for the other role. And clearly, the conversation for demonstration is powerful and critical and meets our mission. But our mission also is that we be able to continue the mission to achieve our ends.
Yep. Yep. So having said all of that and sensing that perhaps that's as much as is going to be said about it. Are there any objections to us then using the July meeting to not only clarify what we want a plan to achieve, but also some of the logistical things that we are prepared to do as individuals and as a board to make it happen?
That's fine with me.
Okay. I think I'm looking for some thoughts and comment about that, just in case, you know, I'm sensitive to not wanting to be driving this thing solely on my own.
I think it sounds like a good plan. We need to be focused on making sure that we leave that meeting with some specific steps.
Okay.
And you know, we won't be able to get everything done, but certainly if we at least know that, for example, if it doesn't include having to meet face to face at some point in time, whatever it is, you know, that there's some level of specificity to that.
Mm-hmm.
And also be a good way to test and see, because I'll suggest that something we might think about is maybe we set up, recognizing the duality we have, that basically everything we discuss kind of comes in two parts. So we do meeting one, so March is the theoretical meeting, April is the practical meeting, May is the theoretical, June practical, and so on. And that might give us the space and the time also to make sure we prioritize each.
Fascinating. Practical. Okay. Excellent. Excellent, excellent. So you can count on that then at the July meeting. And are there particular things that you would want us to be including in the questions then that we discuss during that meeting? Besides, you know, what's this plan going to achieve in the logistical side of things? So, for example, I'm asking, what I'm aiming at is, do you want to think about things like who would facilitate such a process and or what's in our best interest in terms of facilitation? Shall it be just us? Shall we invite somebody, et cetera? I'm wondering if there are particular questions that you think might frame the conversation in July to to get us the best possible outcome in the planning experience that we all have.
I think framing that question and our assignment is to think of that question and bring that to the next meeting.
Okay.
Because I'm not sure I can even think of those questions yet.
Okay. Okay, so we're thinking then about what conditions would be in place so that the experience of the planning process was the best it could be.
We can have some of this discussion via the listserv, or at least develop the questions and be getting some feedback back and forth on that.
Okay. Okay.
I guess bearing in mind always that this is a demonstration project, so we're not teaching, we're learning all the time. and we're open to figuring things out in different ways or to have people ask questions that are very different.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay. So I'm hoping for everyone who has been wanting that specificity that you're feeling a little bit more like, okay, we're going to get there. We're going to get to that place. But for now, then, can we turn our attention to the questions that have been included in our agenda that carry us forward in looking at the board's role in financial and resource oversight and asking ourselves, on the basis of all that we have discussed up until now, in terms of husbanding resources and being the stewards of the resources and in a very broad context, what process will we use and what questions will we ask in order to identify and set Creating the Future's goals? Not that this is unlike the conversation we've just had. So let's talk about setting the goals. This one should be fairly quick because we've just kind of thought our way through some of it. But what is it that we'll be doing to identify our goals, especially as it relates to the resource side of things? What process will we use? What questions will we ask when we are considering the organization, setting the organization's goals?
Well, I'm not I'm certainly not a process expert, so I'm but I can just generally say, you know, we should be able to finish out any given year, whether it's a calendar year, program year, et cetera, with the opportunity to look at how close we came to carrying out what we said we'd do. And so I'm not as focused on the process as I am to make sure that, again, and it's clear. Not that it's something to not that it's something just to cause anxiety or worry, but that we really do need to have the opportunity to say, to reflect on you know, how we're doing, how we've done over the course of an action plan in a year, and at the same time to reflect on you know, what else needs to get done and what we've learned. So you know, maybe part of those goals are learning goals as well as results. But, you know, to just to make sure that there's a right, we strike a balance between this theoretical space and the, you know, the space of having clear goals that we pursue.
Mm-hmm. Gail, as I ponder those questions, I'm thinking about the sort of, and I want to use the word generic, but they're really not, questions from the sheet that you included in the board packet, a change sheet. And, you know, I'm looking at, you know, creating the future we want. What do we want to accomplish? What would success look like? Success for whom? What results do we want to see? What will it take to create that? How can we create a community environment that is healthy? What will it take to accomplish our goals? How can we create the future we want? I'm looking at those questions and others in the collective enoughness as well. Mm-hmm. I think we're pretty good at the bringing out the best in each other, but even those, I think those are I know those are questions that are applicable everywhere, but I think what we're trying to accomplish, that those questions are, if we can answer those questions, then I think we will accomplish that.
Mm-hmm. Beautiful. Perhaps we should add, then, into that list of questions, the one that is in this sheet, the question that Sydney just asked, which is, as we reflect on things, where is the balance between what we said we wanted to do and what we did?
Great.
Yeah, that's a pretty powerful question. Okay. Any other thoughts? Okay, then in that case, what process or questions would we be working on as we identify the resources that we need to meet those goals? Are they still the same as the questions rooted in collective enoughness?
Collective what?
Enoughness. Yeah. They came from this the theory of change document that was in your board package. On the second side or the second page are a list of questions that are, what resources do we already have to build upon? What can we accomplish if we all work together? What resources do we need? Not money, the stuff money buys. Who in our community has those resources? How might we, those sort of things. The question that I'm asking is, what process would we use then as a board to establish what those resources might be? I think we've kind of nailed the questions by looking at this sheet, but what process will the board use then in that second area?
So I think from a tactical standpoint, and I know it starts getting circular, but I think once we've done the community impact plan, which should include us actually mapping out a lot of these questions and where the enoughness is and where the assets and resources are, I think, it. In my head, I'm envisioning that, you know, from a process standpoint, it may be, you know, whether it's a small working group or it's, you know, on an annual basis, a group that looks at that. And I think to Sydney's point, you know, says, where are we? Which of these are the next 12 months or 16 months? I mean, we don't have to go with a year. That's not, you know, that's a system that we subscribe to. But if we say, you know, whatever the time frame is, but just being able to, you know, sit through, I think it definitely involves the people who are a little bit closer to the real delivery of a lot of that and the engagement side. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, we need to map that out. That needs to be, I think, put before the board so that the board understands it. And then we need to determine which pieces of those the board is going to own with regard to what effort we need to put to those, what things we feel are important for us to pay close attention to, because I think we'll see that there are priority things, sort of that if that, if this, then yes, that, or not that, that we would have to, and part of it is we would have to see it in front of us, but to be able to say, you know, which of those, you know, fundamentally on the financial side, it gets to the question of what is our hypothesis about not only what the resources are that we need, but how we thought we could get them engaged into this organization. Mm-hmm. And so I think that that's the, you know, for me, that's the crux of these first two questions is, what's our expectation about how these resources will be engaged in the organization? The time frame, the scope, the volume, the who's involved in that. And that then becomes the piece that we are monitoring and assessing to see how it is progressing. Mm. Hmm.
So folks, think your way. Those are important points, and I'm wondering if we can think our way through then, not just, thank you. Imagine such a thing. I just had a smoothie delivered. imagine.
Wait, where's mine?
How lovely.
I want this in the discussion, by the way, of you know, resources for the board is minions who can bring us.
Minions. I'll mention that to Kelly. I'm sure she'll be thrilled to be called that. minions. I want to get to the point of, you know, exactly who is it involved in these deliberations? Are these reports that come to the board, or is it the board itself involved in making, you know, identifying and evaluating where we're at? So I guess on the strength of the conversations where we've been talking about how we very much want this to be much more specific to creating the future, what do you see us actually doing? Not theoretically, but what do you see us actually doing or needing to do? Because there are some really exciting opportunities embedded in some of these, and assume that, you know, it's us. There isn't anybody else who's going to be doing this. It's us.
Gail, you talk about exciting opportunities. Tell me what you're thinking about.
Well, I'm when I started, when I was noting the things that Justin was mentioning, you know, in the is it a small working group? Is it the whole board? Is it the people who are closest to the work? Is it the board who reviews and evaluates, or does the board actually gather the information itself? Does the board create selection criteria? Who creates the selection criteria? Who applies the selection criteria? Is it to just resource development, or is it to programming? Is it? There's lots of different moving parts to this, and if we are going to have a role in husbanding and strengthening and monitoring, how do we see our, well, maybe it's not ourselves, how do we see the Creating the Future board, assuming that we're creating a legacy for those who come after us, you know, how best to position the board to be in some of those places, especially knowing that we are probably going to be an organization that doesn't have a huge staff to do some of these pieces. That's my speculation. I'm completely wrong.
Well, that's the critical, I mean, you use the word husbanding. Actually, and because it sort of strikes at the heart of the relationship, the marriage between organizations and boards, and then you know there's stewardship that's always used too. But really, what's the how do you draw the line? Is there a line between the board and the organization? And how do we define what a board really does? Which I would love to know the answer to that, since that's what I've spent most of my adult life trying to figure out. I mean, there is no specific answer. We understand that, but it is a point of tremendous confusion for everyone.
So absolutely. The thing that's just bubbling up in my head is sort of how this takes us back to the bylaws question. In terms of what you were saying, Alexandra, which is what I'm really taking away from this is there isn't an answer. Well, the answer is the questions that the board is asking on an ongoing basis that determines that engagement. I think to your question, Gail, I think it is the job on an ongoing basis for the board to, you know, again, once the plan has been articulated, and that is a big hurdle, but once we've gotten that in place, then I think our role is to say, what is it that we think it will take to do this? What is the role of the board in executing that? And that actually defines who it is. You know, and I think I am reading into the silence that you're hearing on this end is it's hard to know who it's going to be when we don't know what it is.
Yep.
And so what I'm thinking, what I keep saying is, well, the question that you just asked is the question that when we're going through the planning process, particularly for the kickoff, you know, the big launch, but as we continually go through that process as a board, that's our role, to continue to come back and say, what did we think it was going to take to do this? What did we say the board leadership was going to be doing? What did we say staff? What did we say fellows? What did we say, you know, everyone was going to be doing? How is that going? Do we need to revisit that and rethink? What are the resources we have to make this move forward? And I think to your point about the board legacy, the board will change. The assets on the board will change. And so the has to be constant is the board asking, where are we right now with regard to where we thought we were going to engage those assets and what we got out of it, and how do we need to shift course? And so, I mean, what I led with was, this is really driving me back, and I was going to save this towards the end, but I feel very compelled to actually start sitting down, and I'm willing to take a first stab at this, at those bylaws that begin to frame just what Alexandra was asking, which is what are we as a board? Mm-hmm. What is our process for asking these questions? What pieces are required assets for us to be able to do our job well? How do we continually redefine that job? Because I think for me, the absolute highest potential of what we're doing is to open this up to say there is no job description that will be static for board members across organizations. We will never have the answer that Alexandra was asking for, but we have this incredible potential to create what we're hearing a lot of rhetoric around, which is dynamic organizations, in how we instill that's the role. The role is a dynamic group of leaders that continually pose these questions that have embedded in them the kind of accountability I think that Sydney's talking about, which says, where are we? What have we learned? What do we need to do differently? And that we know that in asking that question, it puts everything on the table. Not to rethink all over again, but to say, that didn't work. That did work.
And to be just as appreciative of what didn't work as for what we learned from it as what does work for moving us forward.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
And with the expectation, I think, as Justin was saying, that it's not just that the board will change, but the organization must change. I mean, we're at the beginning. We know that. And that those two things, those two groups, the board and the organization, will be at different points within their own growth cycles. And there's been just, you know, tons of work done on the life cycle of organizations, not so much done on the life cycle of boards, because I don't think people understand what the life cycle of boards is, but to be thinking about the fact that those two things will be happening, those two growth cycles will be happening simultaneously and not necessarily predictably.
Mm-hmm. I do think it's important, though, that there be, and I think that the questions you're talking about, Justin, do that, a mechanism, a process, a methodology, a culture that even though the board basically is what's needed when it's needed, which is sort of what you're saying, what's needed at, you know, for the organization at the time, that there is a transmission of these, the re-examination to the next board. And by that, I'm saying I have been involved in organizations that will have a group of people together who are the board, who are dynamic and are thoughtful and are caring and are, add whatever adjectives you want, that they're, over time the board changes, and for the lack of that mechanism, whatever it is, it changes those questions aren't being asked anymore. And so I see that that's an important part of this process, is how do you embed that into the organization, into the board, into the culture, so that it perpetuates beyond the group of smiling faces that happen to be up here now.
Mm-hmm. Other thoughts? Yeah.
Alex, being the senior new person here, any wisdom from your perspective and the organizations that you've been with and what you're doing now?
Well, part of what I've been thinking on, which is the tough part and why I haven't had a good answer yet, is thinking about the sort of cycles that we talk about, but also how those cycles overlap. So where are the places that the board can actually be really proactive and help, and where are the places that it slows down? And keeping that in mind with the idea that we've talked about, I think we're all kind of on the same page with the value that we're not just kind of the board, but that part of what a board means is that we are actually saying we're part of creating the future. So it's not just kind of advisory and totally separate. That said, what I see in a lot of the organizations that I work with is that the board, not as thoughtful perhaps as a board as we have, is that they basically get in the way with a lot of things. They either set what seem to be arbitrary goals, or goals that make sense at once but are kind of fixed, or they're very slow in making decisions. And so I'm trying not to be too, thinking about the positive language of creating the future, not be to avoid the negative. That's what I kind of keep coming back to. It's just I've seen a lot of examples with boards that aren't quite doing that. So I'm trying to think about, well, okay, so take the opposite of how do we really align these cycles? So we meet once a month, because I mean, we couldn't meet more than that, of course. But how do we align that with taking decisions and giving that feedback so it's a really productive type of board? So unfortunately, that's sort of more questions still going on than I'm trying to sort through. That's at least where I'm thinking.
Sometimes the answers are silently embedded within the questions, though, aren't they? You can hear the answers once you ask the questions.
Yep.
I was just thinking in what Alex was saying, and also I think to Alexandra's point about, you know, different life cycles, and I really appreciate one of the leaders of the local foundation talked about the different timelines. You know, a day for the board, for us, that's a month. You know, the day for the staff is, you know, 12 hours. and so when you think to what Alex was saying about decision making, for us, what seems like, you know, we're contemplating a decision with diligence is 3 months, which is not necessarily the rapidity. But I just was drawn to the Pollyanna principle about systems, that time is definitely an issue and a variable that's always important to be cognizant of. But even when Alec was saying we meet once a month, and I was thinking, think about just the anachronistic concept of meeting that we had, which was it used to be you had to come together and actually be in the same room and talk. And we've come a long way in terms of unleashing the potential for people to communicate and to share what a meeting is supposed to do in many other formats.
Yeah, and
so,
cool.
So there's almost, you know, setting aside the legal implications, which bylaws have to deal with and corporate responsibility, but I think to Alex's point, this really deep question of, from a leadership perspective, if we think about the board as part of the leadership team, what do we have to do to put in place for them to be available and engaged to the degree that they can in support of what we're all trying to accomplish? And I feel like I just went like totally esoteric, but it was just sort of an observation, and I think that trying to pull back to even the financial piece, because we know that the financial oversight is only a sliver, and I actually want to try and not use oversight per Dimitri's concern about that hierarchical component, but the financial responsibility that we have of husbanding and stewarding, you know, it's the same type of thing as, you know, how do we honor the amount of information we need to have to be contributors to that collective decision making in a way that's supportive of what the organization needs to move day to day.
You know, I'm so glad you mentioned the sort of traditional, maybe more traditional thinking that we come into, we run up against, Justin, because I'm certainly aware of and conscious of the people who would say to us, look, you have legal responsibilities. You know, when it comes to talking about money, you know, you have a duty of care and you should be thinking about that and only that, and therefore, you know, it doesn't really matter how you catalyze the best from everyone, because, you know, it's just, it's your duty. Contrasting that, and we have heard that in the not too distant past from people who, you know, for them, that's the reality of what a board is. How do you contrast that, or what does it mean for us to contrast that with what you just asked, which is, how do we, what do we need to do to create for board members a condition or a context in which they can contribute, or we can each contribute as much as is possible for us within the you know, the constraints of what we have available, each of us individually. I'm hoping when we do our planning work that we can get right down to that level of conversation. Mm-hmm. What does this mean for us as individuals to create the conditions for each of us to be not just successful, but contributing?
That's such a great point, Justin. Just thinking about the, what does leadership mean in a context where we can, we don't have to have a 30-day, 60-day, 15-day gap between our interaction and our oversight, you know, for lack of a better word. You know, what does it mean in this world, in this day, in this age, and what does it mean with the overlay of the leadership thinking that you've been posting about? And, you know, what is a leader, and, you know, the board members as leaders as opposed to board members as stewards of the money.
Does that mean that the board only speaks with one voice in so far as is only speaking during the constituted board meeting? Or are there other alternatives that we may want to explore?
What do you mean during the board meeting?
Well, typically what we understand, you know, the reason for the monthly meetings, et cetera, is that board deliberations happen within the context of the, you know, duly constituted beginning and end agenda, formal rules and regulations, etc., as opposed to individuals offering their insights or small groups offering their insights and then calling that a board decision. You know, that sort of thing, that very traditional approach, that very legal approach to what we understand a board to be doing, what possibilities does it open up if we perhaps recognize that boards might be doing things outside of a board meeting?
Well, I think if they can, I love the idea of them doing things outside the board meeting, but I do think there has to be a sense of the board having one voice in terms of decisions that you make or beliefs or value structure or because otherwise you have people going out representing that the board is doing this or that, and you know we're not hiding anything from anybody. Anybody can listen to us. So it's not about giving away secrets because we've carefully discussed what things we feel should be private, and they're very minimal, and they're for the protection of individuals typically. But I feel like the board has to have. Speaking with one voice, meaning not that only one person can talk, but that we have a collective understanding that is very, very clear.
Mm-hmm. Cool.
I always come to this, so it was, I mean, as you were talking, sorry, I'm stripping away all the language. Coming back to what we had talked about last time, which is this is a group of leaders coming together to lead the organization, or that we are a leadership body. I think to Dimitri's question, we would never, and to yours, Gil, I think outside of this context, we would never expect a group of people coming together to lead an initiative to always speak with one voice,
right,
to always have to have 100% consensus, to not be able to do work on the side. I think, you know, if we come at it from that perspective, which is what, you know, leadership is taking what it's I think to what Alexandra was saying, we have to know where we're going. We have to have a common direction and a common purpose. And we all have to understand that and subscribe to that and support that. Our job is to figure out how to navigate getting there. Doing that and bringing ourselves together. And I think that, you know, the place where it's dicey is I do not think board members should be able to individually commit the organization and its resources to anything without that coming back. That's an organizational decision, and that's part of our obligation of being part of the team. We don't get to, but I think in terms of what we can bring and how we can be engaged with each other and how we can think about our work in the context of leading the organization, that, again, it comes around to what is the best way to organize that so that we can be effective, given the resources that we have. And it's giving permission to say there are no strict prescriptions in this approach. There is a process of, you know, ensuring that we're clear on where we're going, evaluating where we are and getting there, and then figuring out where all of us are comfortable with the resources being engaged so that it's okay if you know that, you know, I'm going to be off writing a blog post to represent the organization about an issue. That's fine. it doesn't have to come back to full consensus. Or, you know, if, you know, Alex is out there and he's got some incredible opportunity with, you know, just turning all of Scandinavia upside down, you know, and speaking on this behalf. Like, you know, again, we want to be thinking about, well, what does it mean? What kind of opportunities is he creating? Those opportunities come back to the organization for the deliberation and the consideration of us. But I think just far too often we just instantly limit the opportunity for things to present themselves. It does pose, and this is where I think the discipline of us as board members, and I do think this is what we need to be very clear about articulating in our responsibilities, is how do we monitor ourselves as individuals in that process to say, okay, here I am working on behalf of and as a leader of creating the future. What questions do I have to keep in my mind? You know, am I committing resources that I'm not in a position to commit? Am I representing a view that is part of that shared view of the organization, or is it something that's mine? Is this something that feels like it's bigger than just me? Do I need to engage other people? You know, again, it's a series of questions, but just as we've been thinking about a lot of these things, the questions can frame us to think about the answer that we want to see as an, or the answer that we need as an organization, as opposed to looking to see where the answer is already written down, because we know the answer is not written down anywhere.
Mm-hmm. And we've also created a different, I don't know, animal. The meetings are public. There is, the possibility of criticizing, which nobody in their right minds would do, because what could be criticized here? But you know, it opens a different arena. So many people are watching, and so there's a level of understanding that we'd have to have about that too, about do we have a right to discuss what goes on here in smaller groups elsewhere or whatever? Must it always be public? And that isn't just about, you know, the issues we've already discussed about privacy, but and we haven't really had committee meetings yet. How does that work? What does, particularly given the fact that we want to do everything, it doesn't have to be demonstrably public, but what we come out, what we decide is open to the public, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, everybody may not be watching. But...
So, that kind of leads to the next concept, which is about minimizing risk, understanding what risk is for the organization and taking the steps that we need to take to mitigate the trapdoors that could open up. So is it okay with you if we shift gears so that we can think about that in terms of the process and the questions? What processes would we use to figure out risk on any given area, and what questions are we going to be asking in order to assess or to understand the risks that might be in front of us?
Can you repeat that again?
Sure. As Alexander described the question about operations, our board always operating in public, our board not having defined committees at this point and not really having defined if there ever a time when we do things not live online in a Google Hangout, it sort of segues to the concept of risk and the board's role in understanding, getting its arms around the things that could happen and how to mitigate those things. So the question that we had decided to consider was, what process would we use in order to assess or to minimize risk when it comes to the, in this particular case, it was financial responsibility, but we seem to be kind of bridging the two worlds of the broader organization as well as those resource responsibilities. So how will we know when there's risk? What will we be doing to figure it out? And what questions will we be asking in order to assure that we figure out a way to minimize it?
So I'm still struggling a little bit to catch up to everything, and maybe that I'm new, but kind of the combination of being new but also being very theoretical is I'm still not too grounded in what exactly are the decisions we might be taking where there is risks. I don't know, maybe there's we could walk through an example of a decision from the past or something that might be coming up, and just sort of think through, and that might be instructive if we were to think about kind of making our own case study almost. Because I'm just not sure even what questions I would be asking without even being sure on what we'd be risk mitigating against. Does that make sense?
Yep, it makes complete sense. I think that you could consider program opportunities that we might be we might be thinking about engaging, or contributions, donations, relationships, partnerships, etc. that we might be embarking upon. What would it look like for us to be examining where the risks might be, as well as what we would do, and so what process would we use to examine and minimize risk in those things? Program, relationships, partnerships, financial contributions. Would those, are there any others that anybody else can think of?
Well, I think of a very real one sitting right here, you know, so Candace, as, you know, a commitment, and I think the ongoing conversation that we've also had around Dimitri and Hildy and compensation, that, you know, we've made a commitment to Candace as an organization. And we talked about this, Candace, you'll know now, we talked about this prior to even thinking about, you know, moving forward with this, of what does it mean? Can we sustain that? What are the implications for that? You know, whomever steps into that, what does it mean for the organization? I think Hildy did something personally in terms of her commitment to the organization that sort of minimized our risk, the risk that she took on a lot of it. And we know that Dimitri has also taken on a lot of the risk by just his commitment of time without compensation. So it's not like we have the risk of losing him because he's so invested. but I think that those are the types of things when we start to think about what programs are we pursuing, what types of activities, you know, what's the immersion course and the, you know, implications for that on staff. And I think those are the types of risks that we, you know, we need to be considering, I think, to give weight to some to your question, Alex, of give us an example. I don't think we're not at the point of, oh, are we going into a lease or buying a building or, you know, taking on a big government contract that has lots of, you know, inherent obligations built into it that we could be potentially liable for as an organization and in some cases even as individuals. but, you know, I think it's how we approach those decisions from the standpoint of what's the potential risk or cost, or what is the commitment? Oftentimes that's what risk is. It's what's the future commitment that we're putting on the table for ourselves that we wouldn't want to renege on.
Yeah, and that takes it out of, and thank you, Justin, for that, you know, explaining it that way. That takes it out of the very traditional, are we violating any legal codes? Do we have adequate HR policies? Do we, you know, the very, internal focused sort of business normal risk related issues. And this looks more from a, looks at it more from a, and not that I'm not picking on business because there's risk in the external of what they do as well, a lot. But this is looking at it more from that philosophical standpoint, along with the legalistic standpoint.
So when you think about that description, that background, those potential or theoretical situations, or and some of them very real for us, I want you to imagine yourselves in the position where it's you must now frame questions that would allow us to know when we're facing risk, what we're going to do about that, and how we would mitigate the risks that we are facing. What questions might we be answering or asking, sorry, in addition to what's the potential time frame or cost involved, what commitment might we be making, and how will we see that through? Can you think of any other questions that it might be important for us to be considering?
So I was writing down, sorry, I'm looking down, but I'm looking at my words. What commitment are we making in doing X? Or what commitment have we made? What will it take to honor that commitment in the future? What could compromise our ability to honor that in the future? But mm-hmm. I think it gets to, I mean, even some of the things that Dimitri was talking about, and I don't think this is a sort of nuts and bolts of the full board question, but it is that question, well, why do you have personnel policies? Well, because you're committing to creating a healthy work environment for people. and that the policies are something that are supposed to make that possible. That's the commitment we've made. And so we have to put things in place to make sure we're honoring that commitment as an organization.
I agree. Not to be too nitpicky, but what's a commitment? I think we have to define that.
Mm.
What does that mean that we're committing to it? Is it just like something we'll discuss, or are we going to create policies, written policies, or collective understandings, or whatever? What does that mean?
Yep. And as an think of how many organizations don't ask that question. Who borrow policy from others, et cetera, who really never think about the depth of what it means to make a commitment and what it means for them to make a commitment and to whom. Okay. I apologize, folks, because these are such theoretical questions. They are so broad. It's so difficult to get our heads around this stuff, especially in the absence of a plan. So I really do appreciate your patience and your willingness to make our way through this today. I'm conscious that it's 10 minutes before the hour, so we have about 10 minutes to wrap up. And I want to know if there is anything else about this piece of the work that you wanted us to think about or needs to be carried over, anything. Before we move into reflection.
Gail, one thing I think it's inherent in the risk is using that same language, the reward, but what's kind of, and not saying reward, but the upside, like going forward with this will make what possible, and then also is this a shared commitment, like we're in on this and we have such a strong relationship with this organization or that individual that this is a shared risk because we so see it so essential to achieving X. So it's different when the burden, burden's the wrong word as well because it feels bad, but the burden or the potential for what can be is shared with the organization plus X plus Y plus Z who are all in it together and shouldering that risk.
Mm. Thank you. Beautiful.
Thank you, Rebecca. I was having a problem as I thought back myself that risk is such a negative term. And in the recent blog post a while back on, why SWOT is bad, it's the threat component and it focuses you on focuses you in an area that really is sort of energy depleting and can spiral you into a pretty unproductive place.
The other thing that's interesting about risk is that it actually calls upon all of us to be extremely intentional about our values. And if we don't know what those are, then it's going to be even harder to make our way through thinking about ahead of time, you know, what could go wrong and what would we do when that happens. Mm-hmm. But it seems to me that it's another stab at a conversation about values. Mm-hmm. But we never acknowledge it to be that. We think of it in insurance terms. You know, we'll have all of these things in place and we'll be covered. So I really appreciate those two questions in particular, Rebecca, because they talk about honoring rather than protecting. Okay. So, can we, as our time is winding down, and we've committed ourselves for in the next month to a discussion about what our plan will look like, the planning process will look like, and we've also thought our way through, or no, we've also noted that we will be able to use our listserv for conversation about maybe some of the specifics of the process itself or the questions we might want to be asking that will happen related to the process. And then we've just spent time kind of clarifying what are the pieces that we want to have in place and be thinking about as it relates to how we would go forward in a theoretical way as it is connected to financial responsibility and resource responsibility. What are the things that are sticking out for you about this conversation today? And again, I acknowledge that it's been difficult because it's so theoretical. However, what is it that you're taking away? What will the and also has there been anything today that you could see yourself applying in other situations?
You know, what I'm struck by, as I'm so often struck by with creating the future, is that there are templates for everything here, dozens of them. There are templates in the law. There's templates in all kinds of not-for-profit, whatever. And and it's possible that we may in fact use some of that language or whatever. But we're starting with the premise that we will examine this ourselves. And this is incredibly exciting. I think that. That all these little things that are just left over by most people, and they'll create a committee, or they'll like bylaws, or just like you can find all kinds of templates or whatever. It's really looking at it all over again, and I don't know that this has ever been done. That somebody's really, that any group has set out to do exactly what we're doing here.
Beautiful.
I am, first I'm thankful because, as I said, I'm willing and excited to take a first stab at framing some of the bylaws, and just this conversation has helped me a little bit in being able to go back. What strikes me, and I think this goes to just what you said, Alexandra, is this is a fractal process. Every time we talk about the big thing, it unpacks into the same. So as Rebecca was asking that question about commitment, I was in my head, I said, every decision is a commitment to creating benefit. That's what it is. When we're making a decision as a leadership, the commitment is to creating benefit. So then to Alexandra's question, well, what is that? Define that commitment. What does success look like? Tell me if these questions sound familiar. What is commitment? What will it take to honor that, to create that kind of commitment? What might compromise that? have we got everything? Did we cover everything? It's those same questions coming back again that we keep every time we uncover a different layer of this, and this is why I think it's that whole fractal piece. It's the exact same questions keep coming up. what I think we're finding is that top-level high potential. So just like, you know, I heard from what Rebecca was saying, oh, it's about the commitment to creating benefit. Like that's the other times it's about a commitment to some sort of process or it's a commitment to inclusion. But the unpacking that I think Alexandra has sort of expressed the appreciation for is revisiting and rearticulating, like, why are we here again? What was this for? Why did we do this? And then once we got that, we actually have the template. We have the four or five questions that we know if we ask them, we can create that accountability and flesh those out. So I'm just struck, again, it's the fractal component of this, that these thing, the way that we're approaching this just goes up and down and up and down and up and down. And while it may seem frustrating at times for some people, I think we're starting to reveal a truth that is really potentially really powerful.
I'm excited to see what happens in July once we meet again, because, I mean, here's my first day and here I am just kind of hearing everything and kind of from the outside view right now. And having that, the conversation of, you know, what's, you know, theoretical, practical, I feel like today it was a lot of questions, a lot of theories, a lot of what's, and I'm excited to see now once we all dismiss where we go on an individual level and then collect in July on the practical level of what everyone has been saying or been tossing around. So going from the macro kind of to micro to see how does this work for creating the future on the practical level. So, yeah.
Thank you.
I think the fact that we were willing to really operate in this in a conversation as challenging as the one today. I think because it was just like you said, Gail, it's tough. I mean, especially when you don't have the plan, or you don't have, or you're not automatically assuming a template, etc. And you know, it's at times painful, right? You know, I have to be honest with you. But I think for some reason I feel like this very well could be that tipping point that we've all been waiting for. Like, yeah. The fact that we spent the time today to wrestle and to walk in the muck will allow us to really look to next month for more progress, and then more progress, and then we'll start to see, I think, the momentum and progress that we're all hoping for.
Yep.
I agree. I feel like we're really building towards something big right now. My day job, we're doing an exercise straight out of the Lean Startup, which is the exercise of asking why. So you keep, something goes wrong, you ask why, sort of like Justin, your daughter, perhaps. But you keep asking why until you get to some lesson or something you can learn from it. And so what we found is we were starting with a ton of issues, and we sort of built down to the why and to get to the actions. And we started realizing there's actually a ton of overlap, that a lot of the things, we spent a lot of time going through the sort of first branch of the tree, but then realized that so much of what we had figured out in that first branch was actually applicable to 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. And that's a lot of what I feel like we're working through now, is a lot of whys, but we're just starting to get some of that clarity, and that clarity is going to be applicable to so much more than just perhaps the one issue that we're focusing on. So.
Yeah, and when we are doing our planning work, we will probably find there will be moments like today when it is really challenging to weigh in on the conversation that we're talking about. But it doesn't mean that it's not, that nothing's happening. It just means that it was hard.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
How about you, Mark?
You know, this reminded me of a conversation I had with Alexandria in a hotel in Whitefish. But the whole meeting has kind of been, in my head, been spinning around the A, that conversation, and B, the thought of you leaving the board. And so that's been a struggle for me. But I think the important thing about conversations, as annoying as this one, is that it keeps us from assuming anything. And that's usually where you get into the danger zone with these kind of situations. I mean, you guys have all forgotten more about nonprofits than I will ever know. But where we get into trouble is when we make assumptions about what a word means. And it seems like, you know, counting angels on the head of a pin, but when somebody says something about, you know, like, what does it mean? What does the commitment truly mean when we hire Candace? You know, you got to think about that. I mean, you have to think about that with every employee if you're a small organization. But, you know, what does it mean in the board, in the bylaws when we say we commit to excellence? Well, you ask 100 people what the hell that means, and they all give you different answers. So while it may be something that causes your hair to hurt, this it certainly caused mine to hurt. There is some value there when you keep drilling down on those words to decide exactly what they mean, so that there's a shared definition for the organization at least of what that means. And that's, you know, today you may have trouble putting that in the bank, but when you get to writing bylaws and when somebody reads those bylaws back to you, that's where the value is going to come, because you're going to go, okay, that means, this is what this means. I mean, this is why lawyers put 66 pages of definitions at the front of their documents, because they don't want anybody to assume what that word means. And, you know, there's a reason why they go to that trouble.
Thank you, Mark.
I'm so glad you're part of this board, Mark.
My hair hurts.
So does mine.
You can't even see that.
Oh. Gail?
Yes?
My reflection is on beginnings. That there's so many beginnings in this meeting today. And it starts with Alexandra, who was at the beginning, and she's beginning a new course for her life. And it goes to Candace, who's beginning with what we're doing today. And it goes to the story, which I'm going to go back and play back, because I really want to hear the way you phrase that, Justin. The beginnings around your daughter. I am still moved by not only what you told her, but what you said about what you told her. That this is a meeting of beginnings, and the beginning toward what Mark ended up with, that we needed to do this, hair hurting in spite of, to begin what we need to begin the process to become what we need to become. From a board standpoint, a leadership standpoint, an oversight standpoint.
Rebecca.
Well, I've always been a word girl, so every time we have these meetings, and Mark spoke to this, but it comes back to words mean things. Everything's building on other strengths, like, we're not nonprofits, it's community benefit organizations. It's not oversight, it's responsibility. It's not risk, it's commitment. You're not board members, you're board leaders. So all of the discussions that will now feed into all the language that Justin takes at his first cut at the thing, because it's going to be fed and built on all of these theoretical, painful, joyful, whatever it is, but it's not for naught, because they're all going to come to life in these living things. And I think because everyone's gone on that journey. So every single meeting, it is an exploration about a word that's so commonly used, and we usually change it to be the right word versus just going what's always been. So I love it. Thank you.
Thank you, Rebecca.
I think at the end of the day, Hildy's going to be disappointed she missed this one. I always start out teary at the beginning, and here you've got me doing it at the end. It's been very powerful. Have we heard from everybody? Yes, we have.
Well, okay. I'd just like to say something, which is that these are really, I've been putting off for a while this decision to step down, because these are the most interesting board meetings I've ever attended. And I sit on a lot of boards, fewer now, but over the years I've sat on a lot. I've never heard discussion like this, or focus like this, or the level of not just intellect. I work with a lot of smart people, but the particular kind of smart people who are involved here are real, or thinking on a level I really haven't encountered before. So I'm going to really miss you. And I really believe that what is happening here is incredibly powerful and important. Keep going.
Thank you, Alexandra.
Thank you.
Oh, gosh, I almost hate to segue. I have to ask you two particularly technical questions. I don't expect an answer right now, but I want to put them on the table, and that is, I wouldn't mind in our July meeting, because we're going to be talking about logistical stuff anyway, if we could also explore and maybe review a little bit the day of the month that we meet. I know that this isn't necessarily the best day of the month in terms of which week it happens on, and perhaps even Mondays, for some of our members. So I would like to do a quick review of that, as well as we always intended to do a review of our experience in doing live Hangouts, and it's certainly long overdue for us to have a conversation about how we are reflecting on the experience of having our meetings in this format. So I'm hoping that you will be okay with including those as well in our July meeting, so that we can maybe consider it the reflection meeting. And we'll, it's certainly time, although I don't know how we intend to go forward with it, but we may want to talk about an evaluation of our own, activities as a board. I don't know if that's for July, but I'm certainly open to that conversation happening in the listserv as we go forward. But, it's not a bad time to do some reflecting. Is there anything else then that needs to be said? Are there any issues that we want to blog about over the next 30 days that we would want to get some feedback and insight from other folks around? Okay, hearing none. We will meet, we'll come back together then on July the... Does anybody have the date right in front of them?
14th.
July the 14th. Oh, yeah, right, of course. At the same, the usual time. And just again, Alexandra, thank you so much for everything you have brought to this table and to this board and to all of us individually and collectively. Absolutely. Most appreciated.
Than for me.
We wish we could be...
Hang on for a minute after we sign off. I have a little story I want to tell you.
Yeah.
So here is our virtual bouquet of flowers and box of chocolates and certificate of achievement as a founding board member. And thank you so much. And thank you to everybody else.
Thank you, Alexandra.
Thanks, Alexandra.
Thank you.
I'll see you, partner.
Okay, to be reconvened in a month.
Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye, guys.
Bye.